Hello, Minnesota. Welcome back to the show. I'm Tony Hernandez. I'm your host. We're broadcasting live here every Saturday from 4 o'clock until 5 o'clock on SCC TV Studios in White Bear Lake, Minnesota. I'm super excited. We have a great show today. We're going to be talking later with State Senator Roger Chamberlain, Minnesota State Representative Linda Runbeck. We're going to have Julia Sonnenin, who is a founder of a not-for-profit called Families Helping Each Other. It's based out of St. Paul, Minnesota. And at the end of the show, we're going to talk to my friend and colleague, Jake Duesenberg. We're going to discuss federal finances, the economy, and updates from Washington, D.C. First off, I just want to show, if you see right here, I have a little bit of a wound here. And somebody was asking me, did you get hurt playing basketball or something? And actually, this wound happened studying, of all places. And I was studying. Many of you know I'm applying for my Minnesota mortgage origination license. And because of all the new regulations that took into effect after the subprime lending crisis and the lending crisis of 2008, there's a number of steps that you need to take in order to get licensed in Minnesota. You need to take 20 hours of mortgage training from a federally certified classroom. And you also have to take a Minnesota state component test and a federal component test. So as I said in our last show, my birthday was on Tuesday, January 22nd, and I celebrated it at the MCCL March for Life. We were all freezing cold at the state capitol, but there were still 3,000 or 4,000 people that showed up. And afterwards, I had to study all day because on January 23rd is actually when I was scheduled to take my Minnesota mortgage exam. And so I'm at Trotter's in St. Paul, which is a coffee shop slash restaurant. And I'm studying in the back room. You know, it's a good place. I like to go there quite often. And had to use the restroom. So I'm coming back from the restroom, and you have to open up this door. And I didn't realize that the door is on hinges, actually. So I open it up and kind of let it go, and I'm walking out, and boom, the door came and just slammed me right on the left side of my face. It felt like somebody literally punched me. And I was studying on my own. I didn't know anybody in the cafe, so I was trying to hide my pain and everything like that. But long story short, as I went back and I started studying, and you know, I really think it's a good thing. I started in the mortgage business back in 2000, and back then, you did not need a mortgage origination license in the state of Minnesota in order to originate and close loans. And like I said, because of the financial crisis, there's been a number of regulations and restrictions placed on the home mortgage consultant, the loan officer, in order to make sure that the same things don't happen again. And typically, I'm not usually a fan of too many regulations, but I actually think some of the regulations that they put on the loan officer is a good thing. And I couldn't help but thinking, you know, after these all these regulations are put in place, you know, that these same types of regulations might be good for our members of Congress as well, if they had to follow some of the same types of laws and regulations that they put on the mortgage industry. It might be good that if they place them on themselves too, we may actually see some improvement in terms of serving the people and putting the interests of the people first. Because really one of the foundations for the new regulations in the mortgage industry is that when you're dealing with all this money, when you're dealing with hundreds and hundreds and millions of dollars that are getting wired into trust accounts and wired into escrow accounts, that there's an enormous temptation for fraud, for corruption. And so they put these regulations in place based off of that. And, you know, I think for members of Congress that these same principles may be beneficial for the people, for the taxpayers, if they're applied to them, you know, making sure that the money that's going from super PACs to different types of campaigns that are going from lobbyists to our legislators, if that were regulated more, I believe that the interests of the people could be held first and foremost, as it should, because it's our government, it's your government. Today, I have my first guest. His name is Indy. He is a basketball player. I told you that I coach basketball at St. Mark's. He's a fifth grader. We actually have a tournament at St. Peter's Catholic School. It's in North St. Paul, not too far away from here in White Bear Lake. And we actually just got done with our first game. So I asked Indy and his father if it'd be all right if he would come on and just talk about our team a little more and talk about, you know, what it's like being in fifth grade and kind of what he thinks about basketball and sports and everything. So, Indy, thank you very much for being on my show. So can you tell us a little more? Why don't you just start with your name, what grade you're in, what school you go to, and kind of what your favorite subjects are in class.
Okay. My name is Andy, and I'm in fifth grade. My favorite subjects are probably recess and lunch. I love food. And I go to St. Mark's.
It is a very fun school. Lots of people are very fun and very smart.
So did you start at St. Mark's when you were in kindergarten, or have you gone to other schools?
I went to one other school before this, and in second grade I ended it at Highland Park Elementary, just up my block, and now I go to St. Mark's.
So how are things going for you at St. Mark's? Do you like going to school there?
Yep, it's really fun.
Nice. Well, if you could tell the viewing audience a little more about basketball, what led you to play basketball? Is this your first year playing basketball? What do you like about it? But first start, what led you to sign up for basketball?
Well, I felt that some of my friends were doing it, so I might give it a try. And I found out that it was very fun, and I love playing. Everybody's very cooperative. And, yeah.
So what are your favorite parts about basketball?
Probably I like dribbling, I like lining up for layups, I like free throws. I just like having fun.
Nice, nice. And we just got done with the game. How long ago were we playing? About an hour or 2 hours ago?
Yeah.
Who did we play?
We played St. Thomas More.
St. Thomas More, they're also a St. Paul team. And how did the game go?
Well, we did win. It turned out that our score was 44-8. St. Mark's. We won by defense, good defense. Not that many people reached. Lots of people got fouled.
There were a lot of fouls that game. There's no doubt about that. What do you think were the strong parts of our game?
Probably like, I would say the defense, lots of passing, open shots.
Yeah, and you actually had a couple baskets, didn't you? Yeah, and I saw you're one of our top defensive players, too. You were running around there. You had a bunch of steals and a bunch of rebounds. So I definitely noticed that. Can you just talk about a little more about what we have for the rest of the tournament, what's in store for that, and what do you think our chances are of winning?
Well, we're playing Oakland next after this interview, and we might win. I do not know how tall they are or how good they are, so...
Well, it's not always about how tall. That last team we played was pretty tall. But sometimes the taller they are, the harder they fall, huh? And then, so if we win tonight, then what happens tomorrow?
Tomorrow we play in the next tournament.
Yep. If we win tonight, I think we'll be in the championship. So, so do you do any other activities outside of basketball?
Yes, I do. I do swimming.
Swimming? How do you like that?
I like it a lot. I just had a swim meet before my game.
So you went from swimming, and then you went to the basketball game?
Yep.
And then you have another basketball game?
Yep. And then, that's the same tomorrow.
Wow. That's, do you ever feel exhausted by the end of the day? Or?
Yeah.
You do? So you go to bed pretty early then?
Sometimes.
Nice. Well, Indy, I really appreciate you coming on to the show and telling the audience out there about our team. And we play every Monday at St. Mark's, most of our games are. So if you ever need anything to do, you should come by on a Monday afternoon or a Monday evening in order to watch the St. Mark's Lions play and have a good time. So are you having a good time with the season, Indy?
Yes, we are.
What's been the best part so far?
Probably... having fun with my team.
Nice. Well, Indy, thank you very much for coming on the show, and Tim will
thank
help
you
to get your microphone off and everything like that. So thank you very much, Indy. Please come back soon.
Goodbye.
What a great kid Indy is, and our whole team, actually. It's been quite a joy and an honor coaching at St. Mark's. This is my fourth year coaching basketball at the school, and I just started randomly. I just decided that I wanted to coach basketball at one point, and so I talked to some people at Danny Kiefer, who was the athletic director at that point, and just started coaching the sixth graders, and I coached the seventh graders, and I coached the eighth graders, and coaching kind of runs in the Hernandez family blood. My father has coached football for the last 30 years. He started coaching at Nativity Grade School, and then he now is the offensive coordinator at St. Thomas Academy High School in Mendota Heights, and he absolutely loves football. Has coached, like I said, his whole life. My grandpa was a coach. My mother, she coaches basketball, volleyball, every sport that you could pretty much imagine here. So I'm honored to say that we have our next guest who is going to be making an appearance today. His name is State Senator Roger Chamberlain. He is serving the people of Minnesota. He is serving his second term. He was recently reelected by a fairly convincing victory, despite many Republicans actually losing in the 2012 cycle. But we're happy to have State Senator Roger Chamberlain here today. Roger, thank you so much for being on the show.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah.
I'm glad you had the show, Tony.
Thank you. Yeah, this is our second show. And as you can see, you know, we're kind of working with what we can with the set and everything. But, you know, we're just going to keep broadcasting every single Saturday and bringing in new guests and bring in diverse viewpoints and really try to have a balanced show to just, you know, give people a different perspective, you know, who are watching on SCC TV. And we also are broadcasting in St. Paul on SPNN. Mm-hmm. They play reruns. So the show that we shot last Saturday will be played on SPNN. Actually, it's playing right now. So,
I like SCC TV. I've been here before. I enjoy it. You guys do a great service, and glad to be here. Indy, although he's I think I was exhausted listening to that. Swimming, basketball, swimming.
So. Yeah, I mean, well, that's the kids these days. They tend to do multiple activities. And that's how our whole team is. They do Boy Scouts, they do swimming, they do basketball. When I was a kid, it was a little bit different. It was like, you know, you chose your sport for that particular season, and you chose a new sport for the next season. But, you know, the times are changing, and it definitely is a good thing for kids to go out there and to try out different things so that they know what they're good at, what they're talented at, and whatnot. So I got to ask you, though, first, since we're coming up a couple weeks from the Super Bowl, actually, next week, next Sunday, do you have any favorites in terms of who's going to win, the 49ers or the Ravens?
I'll be careful. I don't necessarily have a favorite, but I'll watch some of the game. I'm not a big Super Bowl fan, but I'll watch some of the game, but I don't have any favorite, I guess. I guess I'd have to pull for the AFC side, though.
Mm-hmm. So are you a Vikings fan then? Or?
Yes, I am.
Nice.
I'm a Vikings fan. Most definitely I'm a Vikings fan.
That's good. Yeah, it was disheartening to see that, you know, they weren't able to pull off another Super Bowl appearance. But I'm kind of getting used to it at this point. But hopefully when they get their new stadium, maybe that's when they're going to finally just pick up their game and start winning Super Bowl after Super Bowl. What do you think of that?
I think it's a loaded question. I it was sad to see Adrian come, 6 yards short, 8 yards short of his goal. But I'm sure the stadium will help them perform much better.
Mm-hmm.
I'm sure it will.
Well, I have to say that just being from St. Paul, I'm a bit biased in terms of the game because Matt Burke, he is, he was 3 or 4 years older than I. Him and I used to work together in the summers. And, you know, he's kind of was a role model for me growing up. He was always the hardest worker, one of the best students. He went to Nativity for grade school, Crete and Dereham High for high school, and went to Harvard for college. And so he's the starting center. He's an all-pro center for the Baltimore Ravens. Mm-hmm. And so we're all rooting for Matt Burke, and we want to make sure that he gets his first Super Bowl. I think this is his first Super Bowl appearance, and it'd be great if he could win the Super Bowl because, you know, he's kind of coming towards the senior part of his career. Mm-hmm. You know, he's not going to be a center in the NFL forever, but we certainly hope that he's...
Well, it's an interesting story. I didn't know you had known him, but yeah, it'd be great for him to do that. Absolutely. Great man, too. Great guy outside of football.
He is. So let's talk a little bit about the Minnesota legislative updates, things that are going on at the Capitol. First, I have to say, I saw you at the MCCL rally. It was a bit cold that day, but you were sitting out in the front, so that
I was in
good.
The sun, so I didn't have my coat, but I was in the sun, so
I did notice your ears were a little bit cold there.
I was in the sun, but after a little while, I got a little chilly, but we got out of there okay. I didn't see it, but I was up there for a little while with the rest. But it was a nice rally for a cold day, wasn't it?
It was.
A lot of folks came out.
And I was actually tempted to go give you the extra hat that I had in my pocket.
Should have come up and said hello.
Yeah,
we'll let you through.
I should have. So what is the difference? You know, when you were first elected, it was in 2010, mm-hmm. and you were elected into the big sweep where the Republican Party was able to win the state Senate majority for the first time in 38 years. The Minnesota State House was won by the Republicans first time. I don't know. I think it was in the 90s maybe.
Yep.
But what is the difference? So you went in as a majority state Senate member. And, you know, can you talk a little bit about just that transition and how?
From majority to minority? Well, it's, none of us frankly expected to be in this position. It's always a possibility, but nonetheless, we did what we could. The Minnesotans made their choice. So transition started with us senators moving back to the SOB, state office building, but there are benefits of being there. We're all close together. We can communicate, better printers and copiers. But being over there, we're obviously in the minority, and we have different challenges now. It's the first time in 22 years, almost a quarter century, that one party has been in power and been in charge of both the House, the Senate, and the governorship, the governor's office. So that presents greater challenges, I think, with the governor, in my humble opinion, is the most liberal governor we've had. And it presents great risks. I think that's exemplified by the budget he released. So it presents great challenges for us and for citizens to develop ways to make things to protect the interests of our constituents in ways that are beneficial. We there are better ways to do things. We're going to try to convince our DFL colleagues that are some of our ideas. They should take up some of our ideas and some of our plans.
Mm-hmm. So is it a humbling feeling to have to change offices and move to the SOB, as you noted?
Humbling is a nice way to put it. it takes a while to get over that. Just part of the process, part of the political process. But it is humbling, that you answer to the citizens. And ultimately, that's what we had to do. We had to perform and communicate effectively and perform and, give the citizens what they're asking for and make sure, I believe we have a good product. We just did a very bad job at selling that product and convincing people that we had the better ideas. So it is humbling, and it just means that we had to go back and redo a lot of things and review what we've done and come up with a better plan.
Mm-hmm. So when you're talking to your colleagues in the Senate, is there some type of a message that you feel, or a lesson that was learned from the 2012 cycle, or do you believe it was more of a fluke?
I think there was no one reason we lost. There were multiple reasons. People talk about amendments and different issues. So I don't think, nationally and statewide, I think you'd be hard-pressed to find an election where people threw out rejected the ideas of a strong economy, where they kept a president that has been a guardian of a very bad economy, and then threw out the legislators in a state where the economy and the fiscal condition in the state were improving. So there's no one reason for the loss, but what we have to take away from it is that we have to reorganize. Again, look at what we did, look what worked, what didn't work, strengths, weaknesses, and find out what the people are trying, what they want to buy,
mm-hmm.
and how we go about putting that organization together, rebuilding, and putting that organization together to be effective and get our message to the citizens. We have to let them know, draw the contrast, who we are. We have the better product, the better stuff, it works, and that our opponents, the Democrats, are back to the same old stuff of they're trying to sell us Pacers, old Pacers, or Vegas. Pick an old rotten car from the 70s. They're trying to sell us that stuff, and it's just not going to work. They're trying to use that and redo it.
Mm-hmm. So when you're in the minority, then especially the Democrats are holding the governorship and the state senate and the House. What sort of advances can conservatives make still? Does it require a lot of, you have to be buddy-buddy with the Democrats and kind of ask them for favors, or you just play like the hockey goalie where you're kind of blocking all the taxes and spending that come through?
There are things we have to work on that are not, really divisive. There's local issues here, pension issue, firefighter pension issue in White Bear Lake, the lake level. Quad Cities up here have a joint effort, a project they're working on that needs some help on, and small notary projects. So there are a lot of different little things we can work on together that aren't partisan.
Mm-hmm.
But as far as the big issues, the budget, the exchange, we simply have a difference of opinion on how that works. We want good budgets, smart budgets. We want an exchange that protects our state. So a lot of things we can work on and do work together and get some good results, and we've had that already. But there are things that we believe just are not going to work for Minnesota, and we will try our best to improve that situation, whether mm-hmm. it's convincing them that these taxes, these draconian taxes and extreme budget are bad for Minnesota and all Minnesotans, and that the exchange is going to do, in current form, is going to do great harm to our state
mm-hmm.
healthcare system. We just have to work at convincing the public that we need some changes and get them involved as well. So most stuff we can work on, but these big issues we're going to have to try to convince the public otherwise
mm-hmm.
and stop them.
Well, let's talk a little bit about the budget, because I believe it was on Tuesday of last mm-hmm. week that Governor mm-hmm. Dayton unleashed his proposal for, which years is it now? Is it the
2014-15.
So yeah. 2014 and 2015
mm-hmm.
Budget. Well, first, let's take we have a call-in. We'll take a phone call first before we get into the budget.
Yeah, hello, Tony.
Thank
you for having Senator Chamberlain on. Very interesting show. My concern is, of course, we had the amendment for voter ID, and people said that would take away people's right to vote, disenfranchise some people. But I know there's a big effort going on in the Capitol about taking everybody's right to vote away by not having judges be elected anymore and just appointed, and then with retention elections. It's something I'm very much against. I'm wondering where Roger stands on this issue and Senator Chamberlain, and then also what is he hearing at the Capitol about this and the type of momentum that's may or may not be there.
Thank you. I agree. The Constitution clearly states the judges shall be elected, and the idea, the legislation they're passing around and have passed around and talked about in the last few years tries to tiptoe and dance around that constitutional requirement. I am opposed to removing the citizens' franchise to vote for their judges. I've talked to the proponents, and there are things we can do short of taking away the right to vote and creating a whole new bureaucracy for retention elections for judges. Doing that would create a bureaucracy, a whole new system, and put the judges behind several layers of government to appoint our judges. So I think there are several things we can do short of that that would help reform the system, get people engaged in electing judges again.
Nice. Well, thank you, caller, for calling in. And again, anyone is welcome to call anytime. Let's get back to where we were talking. We were talking about Governor Dayton's budget proposal, and it seemed to be absolutely filled with many, many new taxes. And mm-hmm. When he was running in 2010 against Tom Emmer, we heard a lot about taxing the rich. It was a phrase that was repeated often.
He said that
quite often. And when he presented or let go of his new budget, you read a lot of the new taxes. And many of the taxes are not taxes on the rich. They are taxes on middle-class families. They're taxes on lower-class, working Minnesotans. Mm-hmm. A lot of it is new sales tax without reducing the income rates on a personal level. So these are all, you know, new taxes. For instance, the personal services tax. He wants to have a sales tax for when you get your hair cut at a barbershop, beauty salons, nail salons. He has other things like wedding planning taxes, shoe shining taxes, veterinarian services. So if you want to bring your dog in, you're under his proposal, you'll have to pay taxes to take care of your pets. If you want dance classes, golf classes, brokerage and investment counseling, these sound like a lot of services that everyday Minnesotans are utilizing. So I guess my question is, A, is that against his campaign promises? And then the other question I have is this just a starting point? Like, did he want to just come out with a budget that was so extraordinary in terms of the new taxes and the increased spending that you set the bar out here and he knows that it'll get hacked away and hacked away and hacked away, but still at the end of the day, middle-class families in Minnesota are going to get taxed more? Is that the ultimate intent?
Well, he's always, just to the last point, he's always said that he wanted to, he was going to increase taxes, and he's never considered anything else. So on a high level, we'd all like a straightforward budget that doesn't use games and gimmicks and shifts to you know, accomplish our goals. But we'd like a budget that give, you know, restore opportunities for Minnesotans, prepare us for the future, a stronger Minnesota for a future. But this budget doesn't do it. It falls far short of that. It's $4 billion tax increase for a $1 billion problem. There's no reform, there's no innovation, there's nothing new. It's status quo. And lastly, it's historic tax burdens on all, as you have said, all Minnesotans in the list you read, all Minnesotans, clothing, everything. And we have to remember the problem isn't revenue. We're expected to increase revenue by $2 billion in the next 2 years.
Wow.
So he's tacked on to that. So this is he doesn't address spending. The problem here is, again, spending and not enough revenue. So again, we would like to see a budget that's more proactive, has some creative, innovative solutions to give Minnesotans opportunities to get back to improving their lives. What they're doing is simply hunting pheasants with a tank.
Mm-hmm.
It's inefficient, it's ineffective, there's nothing new about it. It's simply government gone wild. It's a money grab and a spending spree. And we're going to do what we can to let people know that the Democratic budget is going to cause great harm to all Minnesotans, as you've pointed out.
And have you talked to any of the Democrat colleagues of yours at the Capitol? Are they happy with this budget? Is this something, I have to imagine that many of them have constituents that don't want to see increased taxes on their own personal use and whatnot.
I haven't talked to them directly about the budget. We've been talking about other things, but we have, they're not jumping up and down for it or against it, so I haven't seen great opposition. There's little comments here and there about it, about tweaking this or working for that, but they have not made a lot of noise either way about the budget, pro or con. But it is their budget, and they're going to have to work with the governor to deal with those issues. And, mm-hmm. and we're going to work to improve that budget so all Minnesotans have opportunities. This will crush Minnesota jobs and our economy, and it will destroy opportunities.
Mm-hmm. And what about Republicans? Are you guys going to have your own budget that you're going to propose, or are you just going to slice and dice the governor's budget? Or?
We've talked about presenting our own budget and our own alternatives, but I think we also have proven that, I've answered some questions from constituents. We've proven in the last couple of years our goals, our targets, and what our priorities are. And we did that, and we've had great success. The economy was improving, the unemployment was decreasing, the revenues were up. We paid off the school shift back to about 85-15, 82-18. So we've effectively paid that off, the whole school shift, even the Democratic part of the school shift. So we have not determined yet if we'll present our own budget, but I think we've proven that we can get the job done and accomplish these things. And by the way, the governor's budget plan and the briefing, he's using our budget numbers our savings as part of his calculation. So we thank the governor for doing that, because he's recognizing that our budget plan in the last 2 years helped pull him out of the fire.
Pulled out of the fire and created a surplus, correct?
Yes, we got a surplus.
And the unemployment rate went from, what did it go to, from?
It went from about 7.5 to 5.5.
Mm-hmm.
So we've had success. It's been the right path. So I think that the roadmap is out there. That template's there for them to use, and we hope they come to us and we'll help them out any way we can.
Mm-hmm. And could you quickly explain to the audience what the last budget total spending was versus what Governor Dayton's proposed spending is and what the difference is?
There's two ways to look at it. One is with the shift or without the shift. If we do the regular numbers, about $35.2 billion, he proposes increasing it, the general fund size, to about almost 8% to $37.8 billion. So almost a $3 billion increase. If you take the shift out there, it's over $3 billion. It's about a almost $3 billion increase from what was previously spent. The tax increases, you can say, are about the same. Depends on what you look at and what you're taking around. But to keep it simple, the tax increase is about 8%, $3.7 billion. And it's just huge. we can do the job of the state if we work within the parameters of the current revenue projections, which are about $2 billion more.
Mm-hmm.
But he wants to tack another 3.5 on that. So.
Mm-hmm.
And it's absolutely... It's the likes of which it's rarely been seen out there in the history of the state of Minnesota. So, hold on, it's going to be a good ride. So,
where do we go from here, Senator?
Well, we will, as I said, we will continue doing our best to work with the governor, with the Democrats to get a health care bill that is that protects the quality care in the state of Minnesota and restrains the cost and has proper oversight. Quality care that will be beneficial all Minnesotans. The current the current healthcare exchange is very harmful. It is not there, far from ready. The IT structure is not even close. And as far as the budget, we'll do the same. We will offer them our advice and our thoughts and our concerns, and we will offer amendments on both the exchange bill and this bill, and we'll have the discussion, debates, and committees, and try to get them to take some advice so that we can. Yeah, protect this state's health care, protect our budget, and prepare the new ideas. You know, if we're going to prepare for the future, we need some common sense, solid solutions, new ideas, innovation, creation, and that will come, and that'll create strong families and communities and stronger Minnesota.
Mm-hmm.
But this, the current process that we have right now is no good. And we are working on these local initiatives as well for the local communities, fire and Quad Cities and lake levels.
You know, I've heard some rumors that Governor Dayton may not be running in 2014. Have you heard any rumors of such?
I have not heard anything. I have no idea. I don't. I'm in the political business, and I try to keep up with what I have to know. But you know, even on our side, I don't know what's going on for politics. But let alone knowing what the Democrats want to do. But I don't know. I don't know what he'll do.
So you don't know anyone who's thinking about challenging the governor?
Not at this time. Mm-hmm. Be interesting, though. See how it comes out.
It will be. Anything else you'd like to share with our audience before we bring in our next guest?
Thank you very much. I'm very happy you have a show, and hope to see you again.
Likewise.
I still have a lot to learn, but we can do a lot for the state. You know, we can get these things done. We have a tough hill to climb, but we have to work together, stay committed to what we want to do, and stay focused on the goal, and we'll get there.
Nice.
All right.
Well, thank you very much,
thank
Senator
very
Chamberlain.
Much. A pleasure as always, Tony.
Yeah, wish you best for the rest of the session, and stay in touch, and you're
thank
welcome
you.
On the show anytime.
Well, you're very kind. We'll see how long that goes.
Thank you.
Thanks.
So that was Senator Roger Chamberlain, who came on to the show, and very appreciative that he took the time out of his busy schedule. And I've had the honor of knowing Roger now. I remember when he was a candidate, Roger Chamberlain, back in 2010. And I just remember how hard he was working at that point. He spent an entire summer door knocking in his areas like North Oaks, White Bear Lake, countless doors, talking to the constituents, talking to the families, the folks. And all I remember, my biggest memory is just impression of him is that he is an ordinary Minnesotan. He's somebody who works hard. He's a CPA by profession. He's not a career politician by no means. He's somebody that truly cares about the families, about the economy here. And he's just a nice, ordinary guy. And we're all very happy that he's here serving the people of Minnesota. So I'm going to bring on our next guest. And her name is Julia Sonnen. And she is the founder of a not-for-profit organization based in St. Paul, Minnesota. And that organization is called Families Helping Each Other. She started the organization a couple years. And Julia, thank you so much for being on. I really appreciate it.
It's good to see you again.
It's been a while.
It has, yes.
You look great. And
thank you.
I love the colors of your shirt and everything.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah. So how's have you been staying warm this winter?
It's been
cold, hasn't it?
It has been, yeah. We've been working hard at Families Helping Each Other. Usually the winter kind of slows down in getting donated items for families in need, but we've been keeping the momentum up at schools and at places of worship.
Nice. Well, let's just start by telling the audience a little more. What is Families Helping Each Other?
Sure. Families Helping Each Other is a 501c3 nonprofit organization based in St. Paul. Mm-hmm. We take families that are referred to us from about 25 different agencies, nonprofits, schools, places of worship. And they're families that are struggling financially, and basically they cannot afford basic necessities such as clothing, shoes, toys, books, household goods, personal care products, even toilet paper, laundry soap, things like that. So we collect these items from the community, mm-hmm. and then we pass them out to these families that are referred to us.
Wow. So do you have a central location then where all of the...
We do, yes, and we take the families on appointment, and they have time to look through the items and get what the clothing that fits, proper sizes, and of course children grow so fast. And with the seasons we have in Minnesota, that people always need new clothes for their children. And it can be very expensive, especially for single moms or families experiencing unemployment, hardships, things like that. Mm-hmm. We also help military families. Mm. There are plenty of families that are being reunited after the war, and these men and women soldiers come home, and they leave the military, and they really struggle with post-traumatic stress syndrome or mm-hmm. other problems, mm-hmm. and they have trouble with finding employment. So mm-hmm. we want to help their families be able to continue to be comfortable. Hmm. And so we have plenty of military families we help as well.
Can you talk a little more about... When you came up with the idea of families helping each other, was this like kind of an aha moment that you had?
You know, it really wasn't. It was, I was in a military family. Okay. My ex-husband, he was stationed out in Fort Bragg, North Carolina with the Special Forces. And he served in Iraq. And when he came home, he had severe PTSD, post-traumatic stress syndrome. And he wasn't aware of it. But he really couldn't function, and I had to bring him to the psychiatrist many times and help him, and I wasn't aware of it either. But after a number of months, we realized he needed to get out of the military. He just could not continue to be a soldier. And so it was a really tough time, and because of his behavior, he started using drugs, and he just was spiraling downward. Spent a lot of our money, and I was pregnant and had three children, and we ended up broke. And I'd never experienced poverty in my life. I was raised middle class family, had great school, private education my whole life, and all of a sudden I was out of state, away from family, and broke. And dealing
with
I was in with my children, and mm-hmm. I was pregnant, and I was dealing with a very sick husband. Mm-hmm. So we did get him honorably discharged from the military, brought him back to St. Paul, got him set up with the VA, and he couldn't even live with us. He had panic attacks, and it was pretty pretty sad. And so I ended up just struggling and mm-hmm. wondering, how am I going to provide for my children? Mm-hmm. I couldn't find a job, being pregnant and with the economy. And so I can't just sit. So as I was taking care of the children and trying to find my way, I started formulating the nonprofit and started collecting things from families and friends for a single mother support group that I was in. And it's grown from there, and it's continued to grow.
Wow. Wow, that's when did this start?
This was April of 2010.
Okay.
So we're coming up on our third year of functioning.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
That's a big, I'm sure there's been some ups and downs.
It's been a lot of ups and downs, but every day it's happiness. It's love and it's happiness, and it's what I think we all should be doing, is helping each other.
Mm-hmm.
I think it makes sense, and I think that's what our country's about, and I think we should all be doing it.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And can you talk a little more about, so people come in to the store location, which is where?
Yeah, it's at 713 Minnehaha Avenue East.
713 Minnehaha,
mm-hmm.
Okay.
And we have a lot of people that come and drop off items,
mm-hmm.
and we have groups or individuals that come volunteer.
Mm-hmm.
We have interns and Boy Scouts, Girl Scouts, church groups. It's just very uniting for the community. It's really good. And the families that come in to get things are able to feel respect and feel love. They don't feel looked down upon. They don't have to feel embarrassed or humiliated because they need help. They're not getting a handout. They're getting a hand up. And we also have a youth empowerment group for local youth and a single mom support group. And we really want to empower these families, not just put a Band-Aid over poverty, but we really want to teach them and help them and show them how to get out of the situation that they're in.
Hmm. And so are they're single mothers? And
the majority are single mothers.
Mm-hmm.
But we do get grandparents that are raising their grandchildren. We get single fathers that have their children 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's pretty mixed in the numbers, except for the single mother segment is
mm-hmm.
pretty large.
Mm-hmm. So that's interesting. Then when we think of the family, you know, when we think of the Minnesota family, I think automatically people tend to think of the stereotypes, like a mother and a father and 2.5 kids and a white picket fence.
Totally.
And really, when you get out there and you meet people and you have something like families helping each other in a central location, I'm sure you learn very fast that families come in all shapes and all sizes, and it's important to realize that they need help.
Very true. Very true. And, you know, there's kind of a judgment against single moms, which I think is kind of unfair in society generally, that, you know, they're lazy or they don't want to work or something like that. But no, the majority, they're wonderful mothers. They're dedicated to their children, and the children are our future.
Mm-hmm.
And if we don't help these people raise their children when they're in need in many different areas, then it's going to affect us later on with crime and homelessness and prostitution and drug abuse. And so we're trying to help families now so that the children are raised very healthy and the parents, the mothers, are not so burdened with stress and depression and things like that.
Hmm.
Healthy families are a healthy society, and it benefits us all.
Mm-hmm. Well, can we say one more time about how people that are watching this show or watching it on YouTube, how they are able to donate to Families Helping Each Other?
Sure. They can check out our website, www.fheo.org, F-H-E-O, Families Helping Each Other. And the address is listed there. It's 713 Minnehaha Avenue East in St. Paul. And they can drop off clothing, books, toys, household goods, shoes, of all seasons. We sort and we organize everything. And we take financial donations on our website. And we're always looking for volunteers as well.
Nice, nice. Well, Julia Sonnen, thank you so much for coming on the show. And also, thank you for everything that you do for Minnesota families in need. I know when you're helping other people, you're really benefiting all of us here in Minnesota. And you're also setting the example that we all need to follow in terms of reaching out to people, helping people. You know, there's that old saying that, oh gosh, I hope I get it right now. You can't help everyone, but you can help someone. And
yes.
In your case, you're helping multiple someone. So on behalf of a whole lot of families and people Thank you for the work that you do, and thank you for coming on our
show. And thank you, Tony. Mm-hmm. I appreciate you.
And the website is fheo.org. That's fheo.org. I'd invite you to go to the website and also check out the place. Donate some clothes, kitchen items, anything. I know that especially this time of year with the economy being so bad, and being so cold, that there's a lot of people out there that are struggling that certainly can use a hand up. And I know that Julia's organization, it's privately funded. It's funded by people like you, like me. They don't get any government subsidies or anything like that. So this is truly families helping each other. So families helping each other. It's fheo.org. Check out the website and see if you can give generously to help a family in need. So we have our final and last guest. I tell you, woo, this hour just goes by fast, especially when you just have an action-packed lineup like we had. I thank again State Senator Roger Chamberlain for being here, Indy and Julia. And I'm going to bring on our last guest, who's going to be making regular occurrences here on the Tony Hernandez Show. His name is Jake Duesenberg. He was on last week, and we were talking about the federal budget, the federal deficit, the economy, and other things. So, Jake, welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me back, Tony. It's good to be here.
Yeah, you're looking a little more dressed up than last time. We like reversed. Last time, I was wearing the suit and the tie, and you were wearing kind of the J.D. Duesenberg financial t-shirt. Yeah, and now here I am. I got this t-shirt actually from, or this sweater from my parents for my birthday. So I thought, you know, I might look... might look good on TV. I don't know. I might need a wardrobe change or hire somebody who in charge of wardrobe. But
don't you have a wife that's really good at that kind of stuff?
I do. She's been kind of under the water lately. Yeah. So, you know, I've been kind of slipping up here and there. Yeah. And so
what I remember actually doing a parade with you last year. And it was about 100 degrees. You remember this down in Afton?
That was the 4th of July.
The 4th of July parade?
It was 104 degrees.
And you were wearing navy.
Yes.
And jeans.
Yes.
100 degrees. I think you went through about 4 water bottles through the little town of Afton.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah. And I remember, you know, those are times where you really need advisors, and I didn't have one at that time. But it's amazing. Yeah, somebody to tell you what to wear, but I should have known myself too. But I'll never I remember that parade, how hot it was, and there were literally people that were fainting from the heat. And, you know, I remember coming around the first corner of the parade and I see, you know, I was talking about him earlier, but he was there, Matt Burke, who's the Pro Bowl or center for the Baltimore Ravens. Right. And he's right there with his kids. And he takes one look at me. He's like, oh, he's like, Tony, why are you wearing jeans? Yeah, I'm like dripping in sweat. And yeah, by the end of it, it was you learn, you live and you learn.
Yeah, that's right.
You live and you learn.
It was a good parade, though.
It was. Yeah. Yeah. A festive one, too. Afton on the 4th of July is like a very patriotic place to be, Afton, Minnesota.
Absolutely.
So it was a big week this week, wasn't it?
Financially, yeah. In the out in Washington, we saw an extension of the debt ceiling. Basically, Congress is the body per our Constitution that is in charge of the limit or debt that we can take out for the United States. And we had reached that limit. Actually, we were talking about that, I think, last week. Mm-hmm. We had reached that limit, I think it was on December 31st, right at the turn of the year.
It was the same day as the fiscal cliff catastrophe.
Right.
We hit the debt ceiling limit, too.
Yep, exactly. It's funny how those things two merge together. So it was a typical media-created event that, you know, called to action all the congressmen. And this week, our Republican House actually voted to extend that to May 18th. And
so that means they raised the debt ceiling about, was it $300 billion? Is that what it was?
I think they estimated it's about $450 billion.
Okay.
So what's that, like over 10 times the size of Minnesota's budget?
Wow.
Yeah.
That is amazing,
and that's
isn't it?
Biennial budget, so a two-year budget.
So that'll get them by for the next 4 months.
Yeah, May 19th. Yeah, it's amazing when you think about those numbers. So, but
so,
yeah.
So the United States House of Representatives passed it. I'm taking that Representative Betty McCollum voted against the debt ceiling increase because...
Yeah, she actually voted the right way for what I believe to be the wrong reasons. her and many Democrats out there in Washington believe that the debt ceiling needs to continuously be increased so that we can, you know, continue on spending as much as Obama and the Democrats and the big government politicians mm-hmm. want. The Republicans' idea was to just get past this little crisis once again and get us to another point where they can solve this problem. Now, you know, fool me once, shame on you. Fool me twice, shame on me. I'm not fooled by this. This is the same old kicking the can down the road. It's not solving the problem.
Well, there is the part of the bill, though, that says the U.S. Senate needs to pass a budget into law, or Congress needs to pass a budget.
Right.
Otherwise, they don't get paid.
Well, what they do is they put their pay in an escrow account, so they still get paid. It's just put in an escrow account. So until that budget passes, you know, in the next 2 years, they won't receive that paid. Not that that's a big deal, I think, to some of them. And you know what? They'll probably just overturn that bill anyhow, or that portion of the bill. But needless to say, if they pass a bill a year down the road, then that escrow amount comes back to them. So it's just a gimmick. It's not really helping us out here. In fact, if the Congress did not vote to pass the debt ceiling increase, we would actually be forced to balance a budget, which is what I usually argue needs to happen.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, yeah, I mean, and during our campaign, I said that often. The right. quickest way to a balanced budget is to stop borrowing money.
That's right.
Because yeah. once the borrowing is capped, you can't supplement the deficit with right. borrowed money from China, Japan, the Federal Reserve.
Right.
You now have to are forced to balance the budget.
That's
which
right.
yeah. could end with catastrophic consequences, couldn't it?
Well, it will. I mean, the idea that you can keep spending and spending, taking out more debt, and that there's no consequences is berserk. I don't know how any congressman can get reelected under that notion, but they do. It's amazing. And I think having, you know, people like us talk about this on TV and you know, maybe in speeches, and I do presentations about the subject, and getting that out to the populace, perhaps we'll see some change in the future elections and hold these people accountable to
mm-hmm.
it.
Mm-hmm. So is the U.S. Senate going to pass the no budget, no pay that the U.S. House just passed?
Yeah, I'm not an inside the Beltway guy, so I don't know the moves. So I basically listen to the financial media or just the regular mm-hmm. mainstream media to catch that. And I would imagine the Senate passes this form of this bill or some form of bill. I think they actually have a couple weeks left until they really have a problem making payments. And that's assuming that they continue spending and spending. Like we said, if they balance the budget now, mm-hmm. then this isn't a problem. But anyhow, I think that they will pass it, and then the president will sign it into law. And then once again, we'll get back to May, or get to that point in May where we'll have this debate all over again. And then if I was a betting man, there's the can. And they're just going to keep doing it again. And then, of course, the sad thing is on our side of the political aisle, the Republicans will use a balanced budget in their talking points, but these guys are the ones that are voting for it. And I'm actually ashamed sometimes to think that these guys are in my party because they talk that talk, but they never walk that walk.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, the consequences, I mean, we talk about, you know, there's the pressure of reelection
yep.
that every single member of Congress is facing either every 6 years or 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
And there's the kicking of the can. There's the continued spending and mm-hmm. raising the debt ceiling. I mean, my personal theory is that the incentive is absolutely in favor of members of Congress continuing
right.
to increase the debt ceiling, continuing the deficit spending, and kicking the can further and further down the road
right.
because the economic consequences of allowing for financial reality to hit,
right.
you know, you and I, we can't borrow money forever. We don't have an endless credit card.
Right.
Eventually, you have to come to grips with this idea that you need to reduce spending
right.
and you also need to maybe figure out ways to make more money too at the
yeah.
same time. But you need to balance your finances
right.
and the incentive for our Congress, it's not there because mm-hmm. if you allowed, say, for instance, they held firm and they're like, we're not going to raise the debt ceiling. We're going to balance our budget now.
Yep.
The consequences that would have on ordinary families in terms of their real estate values,
right.
Social Security payments, the military pension payments,
yep.
All these different, you know, food stamps, all these different
right.
programs that are funded, many of them would come to a halt.
Yep.
And it would create chaos. It would create what a lot of economists call deflation.
Right.
You could see real estate literally tanking.
Right.
What that would mean for a politician who's holding office is you're going to get fired.
Yeah. Well, hopefully.
we stop borrowing money. Right. And all of a sudden we realize how much money Representative McCollum and Klobuchar and President Obama and President Bush and all of them together have spent over the last 12 years. Once we feel that, they're done.
Yeah.
And as long as we don't feel that, as long as they can keep borrowing and spending from the endless credit card, they're able to keep their seat. What do you think about
that?
Well,
I think actually you started off on a really good analogy there. Like, we can't do this with our personal finances. It's almost like what's going on in Washington right now is daddy keeps taking out more debt in his credit card and buying toys for the children. And everything's great right now because the children keep getting these toys and these wonderful things. But there comes a point where no one is going to let you borrow any more money or give you a credit card, because you're not paying it back. And that's essentially what we're doing in the United States government. We never pay down our debt. We just refinance it. So eventually comes a point no one wants to lend that money to dad so he can keep buying toys for the kids. Well, guess what? The kids are going to turn against dad. They're not going to be happy because dad's no longer providing. And guess what else is going to happen? He's not going to have any good financing options. Rates are going to go up for any debt that he has out there, and he can no longer afford his house payment, food, and all the important things for their family budget. Well, that's really what's going to happen with our federal budget in Washington, D.C., this gravy train that is currently in place in Washington is going to end at some point, and we can't continue spending this way.
Yeah. And, you know, one last thing I want to talk about quickly, which goes back to what we're talking about, is there were people, and I believe they were serious, about telling President Obama that he should mint the trillion-dollar coin.
Yeah.
And as a way to circumvent Congress to ensure that our bills get paid and, you know, this and that doesn't occur.
Yeah.
Is that a legal move?
No, it doesn't make any sense. You can't just create money out of thin air like that and say it's got a value of $1 trillion, which is absolutely absurd. So,
you're telling me the people that were saying this were completely joking then?
Well, I have no idea.
They were serious.
Well, I did too. I saw some stories and it was reported in many media outlets, and I thought I had either heard there was a convention or maybe a meeting that took place that they were considering that. But you know, I'm just thinking, do they really believe there's some value in a coin that would be worth $1 trillion, which is equivalent to almost 7% of our GDP? So all of our economic activity in 1 year, that there's some coin that's worth about 6-7% of that. It's absurd, you know. So I hope they weren't serious, but who knows?
Yeah.
I mean, these are the same people that can't balance a budget and think you can go to the Federal Reserve to borrow money by printing.
That's why I think they were dead serious about that.
Yeah, so. Sadly. Maybe.
Well, we're coming to the end of the hour, Jake, okay. But I hope you can join me again next week.
No problem.
Thank you again for coming on.
Definitely.
Yeah, so see you soon, and you have a good week.
Thanks.
I'd like to thank everybody once again for joining us on the second episode of the Tony Hernandez Show. A reminder that we're going to be broadcasting every Saturday live right here in White Bear Lake at the SCC Television Studios. I'd invite you to tell your friends and your family to tune in when you can. We also have a re-recording of our episodes on SPNN Television at the same time. So they're going to be playing this episode next week. And I invite you to like the YouTube video, share with your friends, put it on your Facebook wall or whatever. So I got my basketball game coming up. We have our second game of the day in North St. Paul, St. Peter Catholic. So I got to get going, everybody. Thank you again for joining us. May God bless you. May God bless America. And vaya con Dios.